A provisional assessment by the UN's World Meteorological Organization shows that this year is set to be the hottest recorded globally in recent times.
It's likely that we will reach this year 1.2 degree warming level, and we are going to a bit the wrong direction if you think of this 1.5 degree warming level, which was agreed last year in Paris.
L'accord de Paris pour le climat est accepté.
Last year, world leaders reached an agreement in Paris to curb warming by limiting man-made carbon emissions. There's a target to keep the rise in average global temperatures to well below 2 degrees Celsius, and countries will pursue efforts to keep it to 1.5 degrees. There's to be a review of progress every 5 years, so commitments can be made tougher. The long-term aim for CO2 and other warming gases is that emissions should peak as soon as possible, and then be cut rapidly to the point where they're emitted no more than nature can soak up.
So we're already more than 1 degree warmer than we were in the pre-industrial period. The Paris Agreement has set targets of about 1.5 or 2 degrees, so we are getting closer and closer to these goals set by the governments, and to realise those goals will mean dramatic cuts in greenhouse gas emissions over the next few decades, and that will be very difficult.
The report also shows that there's been a levelling off in carbon emissions, perhaps because of the action countries have already begun to take. But earlier this year, on the campaign trail, the president-elect said that he believed that man-made global warming was a hoax.
Say, I think it's a big scam for a lot of people to make a lot of money. In the meantime, China is eating our lunch because they don't partake in all of the rules and regulations that we do.
The activity of one of the Earth's natural weather systems, known as El Niño, has contributed to the spike in recent global temperatures. That's now at an end, and so it's unlikely that next year will be as hot as the past few. But scientists believe that man-made climate change is still pushing global temperatures upwards and threatening irreversibly to damage the planet's delicate ecosystems. Palab Ghosh, BBC News.
Well, our science editor, David Shukman, is here with me now. So how concerned should we be?
Well, it's the third year in a row that we've seen record temperatures. So that's in itself kind of interesting and possibly concerning. But what really matters is how this is nudging the planet closer and closer to limits of warming that scientists have established as relatively safe. So a rise of 1.5 degrees Celsius above pre-industrial levels is always seen as a kind of benchmark. But we're now at 1.2, as we've been hearing, which takes us really into difficult territory, because the whole point of what's at stake here is, can you turn the global economy round, move it away from fossil fuels, bring carbon emissions down in time to head off the worst effects of global warming?
As we saw in Palab's report, new man in the White House, a different approach to climate change.
Well, yes, I mean, it's ironic that just as the Paris Agreement comes into force on November the 4th, the first time the world has got together to try to tackle this problem in a united way, and the cornerstone of that was the relationship between America and China, particularly Barack Obama, but put a huge effort into making this work. Now, if the new guy calls climate change a hoax, and no one really knows what he's going to do, threats to pull out of the Paris Agreement, at the very least, it's creating massive uncertainty. At the worst, in terms of tackling climate change, it could actually dismantle the whole system.
David, thank you very much. David Shukman. The health think tank, the King's Fund, says major plans to cut and change hospital services in England have been drawn up without any meaningful involvement from frontline staff or patients. NHS England says now is the time for the public to get involved in what it calls its five-year plan. Our health editor, Hugh Pym, reports.
It's seen as the most significant rethink of how health services are delivered in England in years. At a time of rising patient demand, a key aim is looking after more people away from hospitals. The King's Fund notes that the sustainability and transformation plans offer the best hope for improving care. But it says local plan leaders have been urged by the NHS nationally to keep details out of the public domain and even refuse freedom of information requests. The King's Fund says the plans involve a radical shake-up of services, including closures in some areas. Examples of possible changes include the reduction of 5 hospitals to 4 in southwest London, the downgrading of services at 1 of 3 hospitals in the North Tees area, and the downgrading of at least 1 A&E unit in the Cheshire and Mersey area.
The cuts in the plans that I've reviewed mainly affect hospital services, so reducing the number of beds within the acute hospitals, changing where care is delivered by concentrating A&E services or maternity services in fewer hospitals where that has the potential to deliver better care and to release resources.
The medical director of NHS England, Sir Bruce Keogh, said claims of secrecy have been overtaken by the fact that we've asked that all STPs are now published over the next few weeks. The extra time this has provided has given local hospitals, GPs and mental health service leaders the time they need to develop a starting point for local conversations. Local health leaders like Rob Webster in West Yorkshire support the process, but he argues that tackling all the challenges will be a major undertaking.
Unless we invest in local government and social care, then we can forget about having a free NHS, because the two things are interlinked. It's about the whole person, their mental needs, their physical needs, their social needs.
Plans covering less than a quarter of the NHS in England have so far been published. As more come on stream, the debate will intensify as local campaigners fight hard against any planned closures.
Well, Hugh is here with me now. So what's the significance of this?
Well, Simon, these plans are highly significant for the NHS in England. They're all being drawn up locally in 44 areas. And that, I think, has been the issue, that they've been a bit below the radar for the last few months. And it's all about the NHS grappling with the fact that patient demand is going up, resources are limited, and it's trying to treat more people out of hospitals. And it's getting all these areas to say, how can they work out the best use of the resources and services they've got? But this could involve closures, rationalisation and all that sort of thing. And I think the King's Fund finding that it's all been done with national leaders telling the local health teams, look, don't go out of your way to tell people about this, resist freedom of information requests, has been pretty damaging. And I think it casts a cloud over the whole process, which health leaders do think is a good thing. They think these issues do have to be grappled with, but obviously they're very controversial.
Well, how does the NHS respond to those allegations of secrecy, basically?
Well, they didn't really try to deny the findings of the King's Fund report, because the King's Fund had talked to local leaders in these areas. I think their view is, the trouble is, if you come out with things before they're finalised, you get protests, you do need to work up the plans and then publish them. So their argument is, now we're getting them out there in England over the next few weeks, and it'll be time for the public to have their say. But the question is, how much say will people really have? There'll have to be consultation if there are closures of hospital units, but there could be big service changes happening in some areas without people really waking up to them, possibly till it's rather late in the day.
Hugh, thank you very much. Hugh Pym. Police in England and Wales are starting their biggest ever crackdown on drivers who use mobile phones behind the wheel. It comes a fortnight after a lorry driver was jailed for 10 years for killing a woman and 3 children when he ploughed into their stationary car. He was scrolling through music on his phone at the time. Special patrols are now targeting busy areas, and officers will be using unmarked cars to catch offenders. Our correspondent Duncan Kennedy reports.
We're heading for the Brentwood area and the Fast Roads, and we're going to keep our eyes out for drivers using their mobile phones.
Sergeant David Martin from Essex Police is on patrol.
You almost lose part of yourself.
Very soon he sees this driver.
He's looking, there he is.
Followed by this man. The driver is pulled over and it hits him immediately. What will happen?
Move forward.
Yeah, I'll lose my job now anyway, so
Police in England and Wales today launched a week-long crackdown on motorists like these who use their phones. It follows a survey showing a third of drivers admit holding their mobile devices. 2 women died in this coach crash near Loo in Cornwall. The driver had been using his phone for 8 minutes. Margaret Luxton was one of those killed.
And where's the butterfly?
Her son says it's been devastating for the family, and says everyone needs to rethink the use of mobile phones.
The laws should be exactly the same as drink driving. There should be no difference, because the effects of mobile phone use and drink driving, the results are the same. It kills people.
Police have released this video showing drivers taking selfies, handling their phones, and every other kind of distraction. Senior officers say it's time for car manufacturers to do more.
You must be able to come up with an innovative technical solution that stops this happening. You've done brilliantly to reduce the levels of vehicles being stolen by using technology. I think they must be able to come up with a solution that stops people being able to drive and use their mobile phone.
As well as urging car makers to do more, the police say penalties for using mobile phones will double next year. But others, like the AA, say it's the police themselves who are not doing enough to tackle this crime.
The government have said that they're going to introduce 6 penalty points for using the mobile phone at the wheel, but we also need to see the police enforcing it.
Last month, Thomas Croker was jailed for 10 years for killing 4 members of one family. This week's police campaign is confronting a habit more complicated than drink driving and not yet as socially unacceptable. Duncan Kennedy, BBC News, Southampton.
Dementia has overtaken heart disease as the largest cause of death in England and Wales. The Office for National Statistics says that last year, more than 61,000 people died from the condition. That's 11% of all deaths. Let's speak to our health correspondent, Smita Mundasad, who's here now. There's only one question, why?
Well, for decades, people will be familiar with the message that it's heart disease that was killing people in England and Wales. But if you think about it, a lot has changed. Lifestyles have changed. Smoking's gone down dramatically. People are much more aware of the right lifestyle to have to protect their hearts. And, of course, treatments have improved. So in one way, this is good news. People are now living longer because we've got better at treating things like heart disease. But while they're living longer, they're perhaps not living healthier lives. They're now picking up things like Alzheimer's and dementia in greater numbers. Doctors have also got better at spotting dementia, and there has been this change to death certificates, so dementia is now given greater prominence. Put all these things together and dementia is now a leading cause of death. But where do you go with this? How do you go forward? The charities say, well, what happened with heart disease, all that effort now needs to come into dementia. There is no cure, and they're saying there really needs to be an urgent need for more treatments to stop or slow the disease.
Smita, thank you very much. Smita Mundasad, thank you. Downing Street says its relationship with Donald Trump is working well. That's despite suggestions from the UKIP leader Nigel Farage that he might be best placed to improve ties between London and Washington. The Downing Street spokeswoman said she didn't remember there being a third person in that relationship. Well, let's speak to our assistant political editor, Norman Smith. Quite a few people having to change their views about a certain Donald Trump.
Simon, you don't have to listen too closely to hear a great clunking gear change in government as ministers seek to rebuild relations with Donald Trump after some of the, shall we say, fairly caustic remarks of the past. Now the aim is to present ourselves as the Donald's best buddy. So Theresa May, in a keynote speech tonight, will say that Donald Trump's success is actually an opportunity for Britain, that Donald Trump represents change just as Brexit is about change, that he's a deal maker when we want deals, we want new arrangements, and that many of the forces that brought about his election success are precisely the same things that fueled the Brexit referendum, a sense that people were being left behind. But my goodness, what a contrast to a few months ago when Parliament was debating barring Donald Trump from coming to Britain, when our own Foreign Secretary Boris Johnson was describing him as stupefyingly ignorant and unfit to be president. Well, listen to Mr. Johnson today.
I think there's a lot to be positive about, and it's very important not to prejudge the president-elect or his administration. It's only a few days since the election has taken place. I think we all need to wait and see what they come up with. But I think we should regard it as a moment of opportunity. Donald Trump, as I've said before, is a deal maker. And I think that can be a good thing for Britain, but it can also be a good thing for Europe.
As for the idea, Simon, that Nigel Farage could be some sort of intermediary between Theresa May and Donald Trump, that has been slapped down by number 10. A spokesman said rather archly, I don't recall a third person in this relationship. And the reason number 10 have knocked that idea down is, well, one, very obviously, he's not a member of the government, he's not elected, but also because he's regarded as a loose cannon by many Tories as toxic, and one rather senses perhaps the person pushing hardest for Mr. Farage to have a role is Mr. Farage himself, who's rather enjoying the fact that he is the first British politician to have met Mr. Trump.
Norman, thank you very much. Norman Smith. Well, since the election, Donald Trump has been busy choosing the team that will support him as president. He's told people demonstrating in the streets against his election not to be afraid of his presidency and suggested that time will heal divisions. He said the new job was a big challenge, but he wasn't scared. From Washington, Paul Adams reports.
I've done a lot of big things. I've never done anything like this.
Just took your breath away.
This is a whole different life for me now.
The brutal campaign over, the winner bracing himself for the next 4 years, convinced it's his job to save America.
We're losing this country. We're losing this country. That's why I won the election. And by the way, won it easily.
Mr. Trump says those protesting outside his New York headquarters have nothing to be afraid of. And he has this message for anyone seeking to incite racial violence.
So saddened to hear that. And I say, stop it. I will say this, and I'll say it right to the camera, stop it.
On some issues, the president qualified his tough campaign rhetoric, but he promised to roll back abortion rights. And on the fight against so-called Islamic State, he both praised and chastised the military.
We have great generals. We have great generals.
You said you knew more than the generals about ISIS.
I'll be honest with you, I probably do, because look at the job they've done.
And in this first post-election interview, Mr. Trump, surrounded by his family, including the woman soon to be the nation's second foreign-born first lady.
If he does something that you think crossed a line, will you tell him?
Yes, I tell him all the time.
All the time?
All the time.
And does he listen?
I think he hears me, but he will do what he wants to do on the end. He's an adult. He knows the consequences. And I give him my opinion, and he could do whatever he likes with it.
This Reince, come up here. Where is Reince? Get over here, Reince.
And now come the first crucial appointments. Mr. Trump's chief of staff will be Reince Priebus, part of the Republican establishment. But his chief strategist, Steve Bannon, is a controversial right-wing firebrand. Two very different figures. Paul Adams, BBC News, New York.
It's coming up to 20 past one, our top story this lunchtime. Scientists say 2016 is heading to be the hottest year ever recorded, with temperature increases getting close to the global climate agreement. Still to come, two earthquakes in 2 days hit New Zealand. Aftershocks are still being felt.
Coming up in sport at half past, England captain Sarah Hunter is awarded the Rugby Union World Women's Player of the Year prize after an impressive season.
New Zealand has been hit by another earthquake hours after a major quake killed two people. The quake, with a magnitude of 6.2, struck just before 1 o'clock this morning, UK time, northeast of Christchurch. There are no reports of casualties, but as you can see, many buildings have been razed to the ground or severely damaged. Many more have been evacuated. Many schools and offices remain closed while engineers check the buildings. Our correspondent Howard Griffith sent this report.
Homes flattened to their foundations. Roads and railways snapped out of shape. An earthquake deep underground has left its mark across New Zealand. Many Kiwis say the first tremor was one of the longest they've ever experienced. It's been followed by more than 24 hours of nerve-wracking aftershocks.
Caravan started shaking, we wake up with a big fright, you know, what's going on? Look outside, see the cars moving around, the caravan's moving.
It was hard. Sorry. Do you want us to...
It's in the Christchurch ones. And let's just put it all back.
The greatest impact has been felt in Kaikoura, a tourist town famous for its whale watching. Cut off by road, its residents were left watching the seas in fear tsunami would land on their shores. New Zealand's Prime Minister has pledged the Navy will eventually bring aid.
The only way through is flying people in and out. It's quite a number of tourists now who are ultimately stuck with international connections, so we'll have to think about that. There's also the longevity of the businesses here that in the short term aren't going to get a lot of custom, you know, because again, there's no access point in and out.
It's believed the injury toll could have been much worse had the earthquake struck in the day or in a city centre. The cost of cleaning up has already been put in the billions. It will take months to piece some businesses back together. But for now, the focus remains on reaching those who've been stranded and ensuring everyone and everything remains safe. Howard Griffith, BBC News, Christchurch.
Every 4 minutes in the UK, someone dies from cancer. While years of research have led to improvements in diagnosis and treatments, we still have the worst survival rate in Europe. But that's not the full story. Experts say that where you live can also have an effect, with people in poorer areas more likely to be diagnosed at a later stage, reducing their chances of survival. Our health correspondent Dominic Hughes reports on a project which is trying to target those who are most at risk.
Last week, Michael Brady received some bad news. He was diagnosed with lung cancer. Once a heavy smoker, he already suffers from the lung condition COPD. But now, with a new battle on his hands, Michael is determined to carry on an active life.
If it had gone on any longer, it possibly wouldn't have been curable. But I think 99% in my own mind, it's curable. I'm not stressed about it. I'm just carrying my life on as normal. I don't go to bed thinking about it. I don't get up thinking about it like a lot of people do, because I've had quite a few friends in the past that have had cancer and died through it.
Michael has lived most of his life in a working class part of North Manchester, a city that has some of the poorest boroughs in England and cancer rates that are significantly higher than average. Many of those cancers are linked to lifestyle, smoking, eating and drinking. On that basis, more than 4 out of 10 cancers could be prevented. Here in Manchester, of all the premature deaths caused by cancer in those under the age of 75, it's lung cancer that is the biggest killer. And the really difficult thing about lung cancer is it's extremely hard to spot until it's too late. The NHS has sometimes struggled to reach those in poorer communities who are at greater risk. So across Manchester, mobile scanners that can detect lung cancer have been deployed to those areas where it presents the biggest threat. Elaine Walker lost her husband to lung cancer and the pain is still raw. So she knows how important these scans can be.
I just wish people would take notice and have this done, because if they've not gone through what I've been through, they're silly if they don't have it done, that's all I can say. It's an opportunity for people to save their lives.
But why is cancer such a big killer in Manchester? Research suggests the answer lies not just in the choices we make, but also the chances that life offers us. A fulfilling job, or what's called meaningful activity, helps to make us less vulnerable to illnesses like cancer.
It means you're more likely to make the healthy choices, more likely to eat healthily, not smoke, be physically active, control your weight, and the like. The other is it relates to the body's stress pathways. The neuroendocrine stress pathways deprive people of control. That's a more stressful situation.
So that sense of control, that relates to health?
I think control, empowerment, is absolutely key. When people are disempowered, when they feel they don't control their lives, why should they bother making the healthy choices about non-smoking and healthy eating?
More of us than ever before are surviving cancer thanks to better treatments. But the next big battle is preventing people from developing the disease in the first place. Dominic Hughes, BBC News.
The NSPCC says its helpline service Childline has seen an 88% increase over 5 years in the number of children needing counselling about online bullying. The charity said last year it spoke to more than 4,500 children who received threats and abusive comments on their social media profiles. Some
located there. What's the reason for this?
Mr. Morrison.
So why did areas come on early? Well, some of the areas that came on were those who have extensive experience of being resettlement areas, so they were early adopters of the new expanded scheme. Others were completely new to this. They weren't dispersal areas for asylum seekers prior to their engagement in the scheme, nor were they...
Just stopping you there, some of them that were quite experienced with previous programmes like the Gateway did not get into the Syrian programme.
Some of those, that's very true, but others who were, for example, the early adopters of the Syrian scheme when it was a small scale, Glasgow, Coventry, Bradford, They then took part of the part of the expanded scheme, as did other areas that have been part of the Gateway scheme, and also asylum dispersal areas. I mean, in all of this, we've been engaging with local authorities and in trying to ensure that we go at the pace that they are capable of delivering the services that we need. And there'll be different reasons why local authorities will feel able to pledge at different times. Some of those who haven't had experience before will want to get themselves up to speed, know what it takes to support refugees. Others, where you know, there are large numbers of asylum seekers dispersed there, will want to think how they make sure that the reception of Syrian refugees can be accommodated alongside those other pressures. So the conversation is going on in the round. What the issue that you're describing is really one: when are the pledges that people are going to make come forward? Mm. And we go at the pace that the local authorities we're engaging with are happy to progress.
Well, could I put it to you, sounding we've had from the local authorities, it's echoed in the report, is that some of them are a little bit suspicious about the funding levels and whether they will be adequate to cover the problems they may be getting into. If you look at the funding levels on page 20,
know at the moment that he fears possible onward extradition to the United States for possible prosecution about the WikiLeaks release of sensitive information about the American military and diplomacy. So he's not likely to move if they say they are going to prosecute him, and if they say they're not going to prosecute him, he's still unlikely to move because, of course, he also faces potential extradition by the UK authorities. It would seem, Simon, that the only thing that would stop him... let's just see who's that. That looks like the Swedish prosecutor going now. They've just broken for lunch. She will be off, but we imagine she will come back later this afternoon to continue the questioning of Julian Assange. Simon?
Richard Lister at the Ecuadorian Embassy in London. Thank you very much. Now, if you're lucky enough to get a clear sky tonight, then you'll get the chance to see the moon at its biggest and brightest. It's called a supermoon, and it won't be this close again until the end of November 2034. Well, why is it happening? Here's the science bit. As the moon orbits the Earth, it travels in an elliptical or oval shape, which means that its distance from our planet isn't constant, but varies. Tonight, it makes its closest pass to the Earth, and because it coincides with a full moon, it's known as a supermoon. At this time, scientists say it can appear larger and up to 30% brighter than when it's at its furthest point away. Many were treated to an early glimpse of the larger moon last night. Priyanka Paltinwali from Crawley captured this view of the night sky, while David Merton sent in this snap from Ipswich. And clear skies over the capital gave Zold Berend this view of the moon in central London. And it's not just we who have been treated to this phenomenon. Amazing pictures from Beijing show the supermoon rising over the skyline there, while in Sydney the moon could be seen peeking through the clouds. Good weather is key to guarantee a clear sighting, and that could be a nuisance for many of us, because the moon won't be this close again until the 25th of November 2034. We may have some rather bad news for you. Well, the staff has, at least, because where have you got to go for a good chance to see this thing?
Very mild. We've got a lot of cloud coming in off the Atlantic, Simon, so it does look like it's going to be pretty cloudy for most of us, but I'd say possibly northeast of Scotland we could see the best of the breaks, because that's where we're going to have the best of the breaks today. But we start this week off on a very mild note. Our Atlantic winds bringing in all that mild air, but also a lot of low cloud, mist and murk, some drizzle as well. But by the end of the week, we have the colder air moving in from the north, and that means we'll see the sunshine, but also return to the overnight frosts. So those mild southwesterlies bringing in all that cloud, a lot of hill fog, mist and murk too. I mean, look at the satellite picture. This just depicts really where... how cloudy it is. But you notice some holes across northeastern Scotland, also parts of northeast England, some glimmers here and there to the lee of high ground, but that black cloud blanket really will be quite dense. And across western Scotland, thick enough for some outbreaks of rain, particularly over the high ground. But we could see 17 degrees in that mild air, when given some brightness across the northeast for Scotland, and also 16 potentially across northeast England, given some brightness as well. But even where you have the cloud and the low cloud, the mist and murk, sea fog, it's going to be mild temperatures, easily into double figures, 13 to 15 Celsius. The winds will be light as well, and that's really not helping to break up all the mist and murk and also the cloud. So overnight, it stays mild and cloudy, like I mentioned. You'll be hard-pushed to see the moon through the first part of the night, certainly. Across northern areas, though, behind this weather front, which will be sinking southwards, it'll introduce some slightly clearer, cooler air and some rain as well. But to the south, it stays cloudy and mild, temperatures in double figures once again. So into Tuesday, subtle changes. That weather front with some cooler, fresher air behind it moves southwards a little bit, but it looks like for much of England and Wales, again, a cloudy day, similar to today's, and a very mild one. But to the north, a little bit brighter and a touch fresher as well. Temperatures 10 to 12 here, but again, 15 or 16 across the south. So that mild air gets pushed off in towards the near continent by the middle latter part of the week, and then we're into the blue colours. The cold air right across is introducing sunshine and showers, some of the wintrier on the higher ground, and also overnight frosts. This wonderful graph shows those temperatures overnight dropping away as the week wears on. By the time we reach Friday, we're back to the overnight frost, and into the weekend, sub-zero temperatures for many of us. So here's the picture for Wednesday, though. We'll have some pretty heavy rain across parts of Scotland, Northern Ireland, maybe some hail and thunder mixed into that. As it moves southwards, it'll introduce much colder air to northern areas, but here brighter with a few showers, but notice some wintriness over the high ground. By Thursday, I think we lose the mild air from all southern parts of the UK, and into Friday, then we're all into the single figures. Cold, some sunshine around, one or two showers. There will be wintry over the high ground and a return to the overnight frost, Simon.
Stav, thank you very much. A reminder of our top story this lunchtime. Scientists say 2016 is heading to be the hottest year ever recorded, with temperature increases getting close to the global climate agreement. Dementia, including Alzheimer's, has overtaken heart disease as the leading cause of death in England and Wales. That's all from the BBC News at 1, so it's goodbye from me. And on BBC One, we now join the BBC's news teams where you are. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon. Now a look at the day's sports news live from the BBC Sports Centre with me, Jessica Crichton. England captain Wayne Rooney could be a doubt for their friendly against Spain tomorrow. Rooney missed training this morning ahead of that match. In a recent improvement in form, Rooney returned to the starting lineup and captained the side that beat Scotland 3-0 in the 2018 World Cup qualifier last Friday. Southampton's Ryan Bartrand also missed training. Both are said to be suffering from minor issues. World number one Andy Murray plays his opening match at the ATP World Tour Finals tonight against Marin Cilic. Murray has already had an impressive year, and it's a chance for the Briton to strengthen his position at the top of the world ranking. Murray overtook Novak Djokovic, of course, in the standings last week, and his former coach Miles McLaggen believes Murray will remain the best in the world for a while yet.
Watching him over the last few months, it's hard. We wonder how, you know, someone's going to beat him. He's in such good shape and just so determined to, you know, to get through every match. And I think he's... What's interesting right now is we have periods where people get to number one and they don't particularly seem comfortable. I think this is what he wants. So we've got two guys who want to be at the top of the tree. So it should make for some interesting competition.
Cricket now, and Yorkshire have appointed their captain, Andrew Gale, as the new first team coach. Gale, who you can see here on the right, succeeds Jason Gillespie, who stepped down at the end of last season in the summer. Gale has ended his playing career to take up the role. He spent his entire career at the club, captaining inside for the past 7 years. England cricket head coach Trevor Bayliss believes Haseeb Hameed is years ahead of schedule as a test cricketer. 19-year-old Hameed hit a second innings 82 on his debut in the drawn first match in India. It was the highest test score made by an English teenager in test history.
He's got a very good technique, but I think it's his temperament. You know, he leaves very well. He knows his strengths and he sticks with it. He plays spin very well. You know, he's just got a pretty good all-round game. You know, people were telling me, you know, he's not a big hitter, but to skip down the wicket and hit Jadeja back over his head for six early in that second innings was a sign that he is probably improving, but he's got a lot of improvement in him still. But you know, he's seems to be one hell of a player.
Joe Root's century in the first test means he's moved up to second in the World Test batting rankings. Australia captain Steve Smith is still number one, but he has a fight on his hands at the moment to save his side against South Africa. Smith helped guide Australia to 121 for two in their second innings at the close of the third day of the second test in Hobart. But they still trail the tourists by 120 runs. Usman Khawaja scored an unbeaten 50, but Australia are still struggling to save the match and avoid going 2-0 down in the three-match series. More troubles for rugby league side Bradford Bulls this afternoon. They've been placed into administration for the third time. The championship side entered administration in both 2012 and 2014. And they faced a winding-up petition from HM Revenue and Customs in October. Bulls chairman Mark Green said he had been talking to investors but feels that pressure from HMRC has forced the club to be put into administration to save its future. British speed skater Elise Christie is now the 500-metre world record holder. Christie clocked the time in her quarter-final of the World Cup event in Salt Lake City, but she fell in the final. The 26-year-old is yet to win a world or Olympic title. England's Sarah Hunter has capped an impressive season by winning Rugby Union's World Women's Player of the Year award. The England captain says she is honoured and overwhelmed to have won. Hunter led the side to a 12-10 win over Ireland yesterday, a match which saw Rochelle Clark become the highest capped England player. Of course, she scored a try in what was her 115th appearance. And on the men's side of things, England's Mauro Atoi Nations and on tour in Australia this year. So that's all the sport for now. You can find more on all those stories, as always, on the BBC Sport website. That's bbc.co.uk/sport. I'll have more for you in the next hour.
Jessica, many thanks indeed. We'll see you a little bit later on. Now, there have been friendly messages from both the Prime Minister and the Foreign Secretary today about the President-elect of the United States, Donald Trump. The Prime Minister's relationship with him was described as working well, and Theresa May has been invited to Washington. Boris Johnson has said that Donald Trump's election as president could be a good thing for Britain. Well, Mr. Trump has been giving his first big interview since the election to the American CBS network, and this is what he had to say on some of his key election pledges.
Are you really going to build a wall?
Yes.
They're talking about a fence in the Republican Congress. Would you accept a fence?
For certain areas, I would, but certain areas, the wall is more appropriate. I'm very good at this. It's called construction. But
so part wall,
fence
part
be,
fence?
Yeah, it could be, there could be some fencing.
What about the pledge to deport millions and millions of undocumented immigrants?
What we are going to do is get the people that are criminal and have criminal records, gang members, drug dealers. We have a lot of these people, probably 2 million, it could even be 3 million. We're getting them out of our country or we're going to incarcerate. But we're getting them out of our country, they're here illegally.
During the campaign, you said that you would appoint justices who were against abortion rights. Will you appoint, are you looking to appoint a justice who wants to overturn Roe v. Wade?
So look, here's what's going to happen. I'm pro-life. The judges will be pro-life. Having to do with abortion, if it ever were overturned, it would go back to the states. So
but
it would go back to the
some
states.
Some women
and the states
won't be able to get an abortion.
No, it'll go back to the states.
By state? No, some.
Yeah. Well, they'll perhaps have to go to they'll have to go to another state.
Well, I guess the issue for them is marriage equality. Oh. Do you support marriage equality?
It's irrelevant because it was already settled. It's law. It was settled in the Supreme Court. I mean, it's done.
So even if you appoint a judge that...
It's done. These cases have gone to the Supreme Court. They've been settled. And I'm fine with that.
You called her crooked Hillary, said you wanted to get in jail. Your people in your audience has kept saying lock him up.
Yeah. Well, bad things. I mean, she did some bad things.
A special prosecutor?
I don't want to hurt them. I don't want to hurt them. They're good people. I don't want to hurt them. And I will give you a very, very good and definitive answer the next time we do 60 Minutes together.
They're harassing Latinos, Muslims.
I am so saddened to hear that. And I say, stop it. If it helps, I will say this, and I'll say it right to the camera, stop it.
So that was Donald Trump giving his first television interview since the election to CBS. Well, we've been talking to James Kirchick, who's from the American news website The Daily Beast, and he gave us his take on Donald Trump's policies, describing them as unpredictable.
I mean, everything about this election and everything about this candidacy and now this president-elect, I find it strange I even have to say that, has been unpredictable. I mean, there's literally nothing like this in the history of American politics. Not only his political views, but also the fact that we now have a president who's going to have a business empire simultaneously. And he'll be in a position where he could use the the vast influence and reach of the world's largest economy and most powerful country to enrich himself, which causes many potential conflicts of interest. We've never seen anything like this in the United States, and I am actually quite worried, to be honest.
Well, that was James Kirchick from the American News website, The Daily Beast, talking to us a little bit earlier on. Here, cases of dementia, including Alzheimer's disease, have now become the leading cause of death in England and Wales, overtaking heart disease. Last year, more than 61,000 people died of the disease, and that's more than a tenth of all recorded deaths. The Office for National Statistics says the change is largely because people are living for longer and doctors are getting better at spotting dementia. Well, Dave Bell, who's from Dementia UK, has been telling us that dementia is not only a cause of death, but also a continuing factor in many other cases.
I mean, the statistics never tell the whole story.
Yeah.
And we know that of the deaths that are reported where dementia is part of that, and Public Health England came out with some statistics for this last month, dementia now contributes to something like 15% of deaths overall. But it's a contributory factor as much as it's a cause of death itself. Obviously, in the very end stages of dementia, systems stop working, basically. Yeah. But something like 30% of those cases that are reported where dementia contributes to the death, are people also have respiratory diseases. Another 30% people also have circulatory diseases. So there's stroke and pneumonia and chronic obstructive pulmonary disease. All those things contribute. And if you don't mind me saying, I think doctors are getting better at it, at reporting it. Something like 40% of those deaths at least occur in care homes as well. So we know that it's GPs who cover those care homes who are recognising what's happening, that dementia is contributing. If you have dementia, it reduces your resistance to other illnesses. Mm. It also means that other people don't recognise symptoms as clearly as they could do. So people aren't treated as well as they could be. We reckon that only 17% of people who have dementia just have dementia. They have most of them have other comorbidities, other illnesses that affect the progress of dementia as well. So it's, as I say, the statistics don't tell the whole story.
Dave Bell there from Dementia UK. Let's bring you more now on our main news this afternoon. Climate experts saying that 2016 is likely to be the warmest year since records began in the late 19th century. The World Meteorological Organization says global temperatures this year were even higher than the record-breaking temperatures set in 2015. Let's speak to Professor Joanna Haig, who's from the Grantham Institute. That is the Climate Research Unit of Imperial College London. Thank you very much indeed for being with us. Are you surprised by this news that 2016 is likely to be the hottest year recorded globally ever?
Unfortunately not. I mean, we've got an ongoing upward trend in temperature, and that's been added to over the last couple of years by a big El Nino event, which makes it even warmer than it would be otherwise.
And in terms of the climate change agreement, are we going in the right direction on that?
Oh, unfortunately not. And I mean, it was great that the people all agreed in Paris to have this agreement, but now we need some action. I really need people to do something about reducing the CO2 and going to green energy and cutting CO2 emissions.
So what you're feeling is that people have signed up to that, but they're not actually implementing it?
Well, let's hope they are. They haven't had much of a chance yet. Let's hope in Marrakesh there will be an international agreement to do that and more.
Because, of course, in the United States, one of the biggest polluters historically, President-elect Donald Trump is looking for ways to pull out of the climate change agreement.
Yes, I think that's very worrying indeed, really, really very sad. But let's hope the rest of the countries will carry on with their commitments. And indeed, countries like China are now very well on message and doing a lot and heading in the right direction. And so let's hope that the United States can realise there's advantages in moving to green energy that are not just in terms of meeting international agreements, but also in terms of reducing energy costs and improvements to health and things. Well, so there's lots of co-benefits.
Do you think the climate change agreement in itself goes far enough, whether or not it's properly implemented?
Well, the agreement said that they'd aim to get global temperatures to well below 2 degrees above pre-industrial and preferably to 1.5. I think that 1.5 would be great. I think that's quite ambitious, but it'd be good if we could aim for that.
And we're getting hotter and hotter, it seems, according to the statistics. 2015 hotter than previous years and 2016 hotter than 2015. Is that the trend you think is just going to continue year on year?
Well, it's not uniformly up every single year because there's other factors in the climate system that make it go up and down from year to year for other reasons. But the underlying trend, it will just carry on going up. The carbon dioxide's higher than it has been for 3 million years. It's carrying on going up. It'll keep on warming.
All right. Well, thank you very much for your analysis, Professor Joanna Haig there from the Grantham Institute. Thank you.
Thank you.
Now, in a moment, we're going to have a summary of all the latest business news this hour. But first, our headlines. And as we've just been discussing, this year looks like being the hottest year ever on record. That's despite global carbon emissions from fossil fuels stabilising. Donald Trump reaffirms some key election pledges and tells people not to be afraid of his presidency. Sweden's chief prosecutor is at the Ecuadorian embassy in London, where Julian Assange is being interviewed about a sex allegation.
Hello, I'm Susanna Streeter in the business news. A claim that energy suppliers are making larger profits than they've admitted to be investigated by the business secretary, Greg Clark. The Sun newspaper claimed that the gas and electricity firms may be making six times more than they state. However, the trade body, Energy UK, rejected the Sun's claims, saying they were a misrepresentation of the facts. The introduction of the national living wage has increased the financial pressure for care homes, particularly for smaller homes, according to a new report. Accountancy firm Moore Stevens says 12% of care homes have at least a 30% chance of going insolvent within the next 3 years. A wave of selling sweeping across bond markets has resumed today as investors continue to digest the impact of the Donald Trump presidency. US and European bond prices have sunk in expectation that he'll enact inflationary policies that speed the pace of interest rate rises. British 10-year government bond yields have risen to their highest level since the end of May. US President-elect Donald Trump has awarded key roles in his incoming team to a top Republican Party official and a right-wing media chief. Reince Priebus, chairman of the Republican National Committee, will be his chief of staff, and Stephen Bannon from the Breitbart News Network will serve as Mr. Trump's chief strategist. So as Donald Trump's political team starts to take shape, we're also looking at who could be his key economic appointments. Mr. Trump's transitional team has spent the past few months quietly building a short list of industry leaders and conservative activists. Well, let's go straight over to Michelle Fleury, who's in New York and who can tell us more. So, Michelle, who and what are the best guesses for his top team of economic advisers, those key economic appointments?
Well, I think people have been looking, first of all, at who has been some of Donald Trump's most loyal lieutenants. And on the economic front, the names that keep coming up again and again, certainly for the role of Treasury Secretary, Steven Mnuchin is one of them. He's a former Goldman Sachs banker who has dabbled in the past in backing Hollywood films. He's been a constant sort of in the inner circle of Donald Trump. Another name is Thomas Barak from Colony Capital, a hedge fund, also being mentioned. In terms of sort of establishment names, if you like, Jeb Hensarling is chairman of the House Financial Services Committee. He's a name being mentioned. He has in the past been vocal of his criticism of the Dodd-Frank law, would like to see that reversed. So from the establishment side, but also some of the names we've heard before. On the trade front, Susanna, a name to look out for is Dan D'Amico, who's spoken to our editor in the past, Kamal Ahmed. He is a former chief executive of the steel company Nucor, has been advising Donald Trump on trade issues. Don't be surprised if he turns up perhaps as sort of either commerce or trade secretary.
President-elect Trump has been speaking today really about what he's saying as his campaign pledges, or rather last night, and he's saying he's going to keep many of them in place. And already there has been an impact, hasn't there, on the bond markets in particular. And it's all to do with his pledge to spend billions on infrastructure, isn't it?
Well, you're right. I mean, people are talking about a return of something that the Federal Reserve at least hasn't seen for a while, and that is the return of inflation. The reason economists and many people are talking about this all of a sudden is the expectation that we're hearing already Donald Trump wants to hit the ground running, and one of the first things he wants to do is spend a lot of money on infrastructure. This change in fiscal policy, government financial policy, is expected to have a knock-on effect ultimately of pushing up inflation. And you're seeing that in the markets here. If you look at the bond market, for example, there's been heavy selling of bonds. The yield has risen sharply. All of this on the assumption, as you mentioned, that we're going to see a return to inflation.
Okay, Michelle Fleury at the New York Stock Exchange, and many thanks. Let me take a look at some other business news around today. And Dominic Chappelle, the serial bankrupt who bought BHS for £1, has been arrested in relation to an unpaid tax bill of about £500,000. News broke over the weekend that Mr. Chappelle was arrested on the 2nd of November by HM Revenue and Customs. They've not confirmed his identity of the 49-year-old businessman, but Mr. Chappelle told ITV News he had been arrested. People aged 16 and 17 need last-minute financial education before adulthood, amid fears that they're ill-prepared, according to holding ground against the euro at just above the 116 level, but has slipped back slightly from last week's closing level in the US against the US dollar of 126. That's all from me for now. Back to you.
Thank you very much. See you later on. Now, let's just tell you that the NSPCC is saying that its helpline service, Childline, has seen an 88% increase over the 5 years in the number of children needing counselling about online bullying. The charity said last year it spoke to more than 4,500 children who received threats and abusive comments on their social media profiles. Some are as young as just 7. Well, they say it's becoming the main type of bullying that they're contacted about. Now, for one Iraqi soldier, the operation to retake the city of Mosul in Iraq from so-called Islamic State has provided a rare moment of joy. Saad, who's originally from Mosul, hadn't seen his mother since the militants seized the city 2 years ago. But last week, he heard she was in a convoy of civilians who were being bussed out of the city, and he began a frantic search to find her. Well, extraordinary emotional scenes there. Now, back here, we're going to look at the latest weather prospects, and Stav has got those for us this afternoon. Hi, Stav.
Hi there, Ben. Thank you very much. Well, the supermoon will be on show tonight, but for many of us with cloudy skies, we're not really going to get to see it. In fact, the mild theme continues for the start of this week. Mild southwesterlies feeding in a lot of cloud, drizzle, some hill fog at times too. But later on in the week, colder air pushing down from the north means things will turn brighter, but with a return of overnight frosts. Lots of weather watch pictures coming through. Most of them are of the cloud because that's what's covering the skies. There's a lovely one here in Walton-on-Thames. Here's the satellite picture. There are some breaks in the cloud, though, particularly across northeast Scotland, parts of northeast England, a little bit of brightness, northeast Wales, and it's here where we're seeing the best of the temperatures, 16, maybe 17 or 18 Celsius by the time the afternoon's out. But across western Scotland here, the fairly strong gale force wind will be feeding in a lot of cloud, persistent rain to the western highlands. Best of brightness, like I mentioned, northeast Scotland, 17 degrees likely through the afternoon, 16 potentially for northeast England. But elsewhere, we're looking at a lot of cloud, thick cloud at times, some hill fog, mist and murk across western hills. But look at those temperatures, really double figures for all, mid-teen Celsius for many, despite all the cloud and outbreaks of rain as well, also affecting the southeast. Overnight, it stays mild, cloudy for most, mist and murk continuing, some hill fog across western hills. This weather front, though, starts to mark a change. Some colder, fresher air behind it as it slowly sinks its way southwards. There will be some rain on it as well as it reaches central parts of the UK. Single figure digits like the end of the night across Scotland, but elsewhere, as you can see, another mild night to come. So for Tuesday, rather cloudy for England and Wales, that weather front slowly slinking its way southwards, introducing colder air to many northern areas of the UK, but brighter here with some sunshine. There'll be plenty of showers streaming in on a strong wind across northern and western Scotland, and temperatures here just about making double figures, but again across southern areas and the south of that weather front, another very mild day. But the mild air slowly gets pushed out in towards the near continent. The colder blue colours take over the whole of the UK by the time we reach the end of the week. And with it, with clear skies as well, we'll start to see a return to overnight frost Thursday, certainly Friday into the weekend. Could see seeing sub-zero temperatures with quite a widespread frost. But another mild night to come tonight, as you can see there. For Wednesday, it's a mild start across southern areas. There will be a little bit of sunshine around, some heavy rain across northwestern corner of the UK, and a few showers as well. Some of these will be wintry in nature, so it'll turn much colder across northern areas. By Thursday, that mild air slowly gets pushed out, and then by Friday, it's cold pretty much across the board, temperatures in single figures for most. And like I mentioned, the return of overnight frosts as well.
Our weather. It's more local than you'd think. That's why there's BBC Weather Watchers, a website where you can share the sunshine or showers where you live, post photos of your weather, and join the nation's favourite conversation. To become a BBC Weather Watcher, just sign in online.
Who knows where it's going to take me? Maybe I'm related to a few criminals.
So handsome.
From royalty to slavery.
The reality of it in my family, it's a tough thing.
Under every family tree, the roots run deep.
How can you get upset?
This is BBC News, I'm Ben Brown. The headlines at 2. 2016 is set to be the hottest year on record. Temperatures are now 1.2 degrees Celsius above pre-industrial levels, creating extreme weather and higher sea levels. Foreign Secretary Boris Johnson says Donald Trump's election as President of the United States should be seen as a moment of opportunity for Britain.
Donald Trump, as I've said before, is a deal maker. And I think that can be a good thing for Britain, but it can also be a good thing for Europe.
Dementia, including Alzheimer's, is now the leading cause of death in England and Wales, overtaking heart disease. An investigation finds that NHS bosses are trying to keep plans to cut hospital services in England secret from staff and patients. As aftershocks continue after a powerful earthquake hits New Zealand, military helicopters begin delivering aid to areas that have been cut off.
I'm Emily Maitlis, and in the next hour, we'll look at a rare moment of happiness in Iraq. This Iraqi soldier sees his mother for the first time in 2 years since Islamic State seized the city of Mosul. Bigger and brighter, tonight's the night to see the moon as you've never seen it before, if the weather allows. Hello, good afternoon. Welcome to BBC News. This year, 2016, is likely to be the hottest year ever, with average global temperatures 1.2 degrees Celsius higher than they were when measurements began back in the 19th century. The World Meteorological Organization, that's the UN's weather agency, says temperature rises are getting close to the limit set by the Global Climate Agreement adopted in Paris last year. Scientists, though, say this year's temperatures were boosted by the El Niño weather event. Our science correspondent, Palab Ghosh, reports.
A planet that seems fragile from space. The sun descends on a world that is gradually getting warmer. A provisional assessment by the UN's World Meteorological Organization shows that this year is set to be the hottest recorded globally in recent times.
It's likely that we will reach this year 1.2 degree warming level, and we are going to a bit the wrong direction if you think of this 1.5 degree warming level, which was agreed last year in Paris.
L'accord de Paris pour le climat est accepté.
Last year, world leaders reached an agreement in Paris to curb warming by limiting man-made carbon emissions. There's a target to keep the rise in average global temperatures to well below 2 degrees Celsius, and countries will pursue efforts to keep it to 1.5 degrees. There's to be a review of progress every 5 years, so commitments can be made tougher. The long-term aim for CO2 and other warming gases is that emissions should peak as soon as possible and then be cut rapidly to the point where they're emitted no more than nature can soak up.
So we're already more than 1 degree warmer than we were in the pre-industrial period. The Paris Agreement has set targets of about 1.5 or 2 degrees, so we are getting closer and closer to these goals set by the governments, and to realise those goals will mean dramatic cuts in greenhouse gas emissions over the next few decades, and that will be very difficult.
The report also shows that there's been a levelling off in carbon emissions, perhaps because of the action countries have already begun to take. But earlier this year, on the campaign trail, the president-elect said that he believed that man-made global warming was a hoax.
Say, I think it's a big scam for a lot of people to make a lot of money. In the meantime, China is eating our lunch because they don't partake in all of the rules and regulations that we do.
The activity of one of the Earth's natural weather systems, known as El Niño, has contributed to the spike in recent global temperatures. That's now at an end, and so it's unlikely that next year will be as hot as the past few. But scientists believe that man-made climate change is still pushing global temperatures upwards and threatening irreversibly to damage the planet's delicate ecosystems. Palab Ghosh, BBC News.
Well, we can speak now via webcam to Professor Peter Cox, Professor of Climate System Dynamics at the University of Exeter. Professor Cox, thanks for joining us. What can this definitively tell us has happened? What do you draw from this?
Well, I mean, individual records are, of course, always noteworthy and interesting, but the upward trend in temperatures is exactly as we would have expected from the effects of greenhouse gases on climate. And in fact, climate science has been talking about this for decades now. So the fact the planet's getting warmer in general is not at all surprising. The rate of warming recently, as your report just said, is partly amplified by the El Niño event, which comes every 3 or 5 years, something like that, and tends to amplify the rate of warming. But the background trend is very clear and has been very clear for a long time.
But if you had people saying to you now, this is not a product, or we cannot see conclusively that this is a product of man-made climate change, would you
take that on board?
No, it's, I mean, it's very, very clear and has been clear for a long time that the major reason why the planet has been warming for the last 100 or so years is because of greenhouse gases, and that those greenhouse gases are caused by human activity. And we didn't do it knowingly initially. We didn't know the planet was going to warm because we were using fossil fuels, but we do now. And it would be very strange for us not to react to that knowledge and deal with the issue and go and resort to some sort of denial so we can carry on with business as usual. And it doesn't make sense for people, for the well-being of people or the planet.
Is your sense that if you take out the El Nino effect, then this is the highest point that we will get to? And after this point, then all the efforts and all the limits that are being put in place will start to kick in more thoroughly?
I'm afraid not. No, not less. Essentially, to keep below the sort of targets that have been spoken about in the climate negotiations, you need to reduce CO2 emissions very significantly, because carbon dioxide stays in the air for such a long time where it warms the climate. So you need to act with foresight in order to be able to deal with these targets. And the natural systems, although they're doing their best to try and buffer us from our own emissions by absorbing roughly half of our emissions, can only do so much. And in fact, when the planet warms, one of those natural systems, which is the amount of carbon taken up by plants and soils, tends to reduce as a result of the warming itself. So as we warm the system, it gets harder to slow it down. That isn't to say it can't be done. It definitely can be done. We have the technology to do it, but it needs to be taken much more seriously than it has been.
So within its context, I mean, last year there was a lot of sort of backpatting about the Paris Agreement. Does it now seem deeply unambitious a target?
No, 1.5 is very ambitious, and 2 is very ambitious given how much warming we've had. So your report said the WMO is now saying 1.2 degrees this year. That's probably going to be a brief spike, but we're probably talking about a degree warmer than pre-industrial. 1.5, by most estimates, degrees of warming, which is what was aspirational out of Paris, is probably about 5 years away. And 2 degrees, which is the long-term target that we've been talking about for almost 20 years now, is only 20 years of emissions away. So this is really, this requires immediate and urgent action. In fact, if you want to stay below 1.5 degrees, you probably need to develop a new industry to remove CO2 from the air as well. And I'm not saying that would be the wrong thing to do, but it's not enough just to promise things or make pledges. And we actually have to have action, and we have to have it soon if these targets are going to be meaningful.
Professor Cox, thank you. Thanks very much.
Thank you.
We'll get the latest from our correspondent who's at the climate talks in Morocco shortly.
Now, Downing Street says the Prime Minister's relationship with Donald Trump is working well and that Theresa May had been invited to visit him at the earliest opportunity. The Prime Minister's spokeswoman said that during Theresa May's phone call with the president-elect last week, Mr. Trump said he looked forward to having the same relationship as that between President Ronald Reagan and Margaret Thatcher. Let's go to our chief political correspondent, Vicky Young, who's at Westminster for us. So, of course, last week there was a bit of embarrassment, really, for Downing Street when Theresa May was it the 11th person that Donald Trump spoke to in terms of world leaders on the phone? Is this Downing Street trying to show that the special relationship is alive and kicking?
Yeah, I think so. There's a lot of discussion about the fact that Theresa May's team maybe don't have the closest connections with the Trump team. He seems to have taken many people by surprise. And I think when Theresa May later today in a big speech this evening will say that change is in the air, she's going to suggest that the parallels with Brexit, she'll talk about overlooked communities, but also how she says she's going to see this as an opportunity. So I think Downing Street trying to make it very clear that, of course, as the Prime Minister of Britain and he as the future President of the United States, there will be official channels that will be open. They will be able to forge a relationship. Now, whether it will be as close and friendly as the one between Margaret Thatcher and Ronald Reagan, well, we'll have to see. But it's certainly the case that British politicians are having to really readjust to get used to what will be a new world. Now, one of those, Boris Johnson, now Foreign Secretary, of course, he was amongst many who were extremely rude about Donald Trump when he said that he would maybe try and stop Muslims entering the United States. Boris Johnson was one of those who said that that made Mr. Trump unfit for office. But of course, now people are having to deal with the reality. Mr. Johnson yesterday actually didn't attend a meeting of EU foreign ministers, which was called hurriedly to discuss the election of Mr. Trump. And Boris Johnson is certainly one of those who says that this could be a big opportunity for Britain.
I think there's a lot to be positive about, and it's very important not to prejudge the president-elect or his administration. It's only a few days since the election has taken place. I think we all need to wait and see what they come up with. But I think we should regard it as a moment of opportunity. Donald Trump, as I've said before, is a deal maker. And I think that can be a good thing for Britain, but it can also be a good thing for Europe.
But not everyone is willing to forgive and forget some of the things that Donald Trump said during that campaign. Labour particularly have been very critical of some of the things that Mr. Trump had to say. And there was a word of warning today from one of their leading figures about the way that Theresa May should approach the relationship.
She needs to be careful not to legitimise it. Of course, we have to work with our oldest ally. But what we shouldn't do is legitimate a narrative which is absurd, anti-immigrant, anti-Muslim, and some argue there are people around Donald Trump who are also anti-Semitic.
Now, there is one British politician who is delighted by all of this. That is Nigel Farage, the interim leader of UKIP. He was the first politician to go over and meet Donald Trump. He was over there in New York. Lots of pictures everywhere of the two of them smiling together. And Mr. Farage, of course, also helped campaign for Mr. Trump. So he is delighted with the way things have gone. He's written today in a national newspaper saying that fences need to be mended. And he says that he has a unique position because he knows Mr. Trump well. He says he could be somebody who helps the British government forge a new relationship. And there are some of his UKIP colleagues who agree with that.
It's very petty. The first foreign leader, or the first foreign politician, should I say, that Trump has seen is indeed Nigel Farage. And we've got an opportunity here to make sure that Britain is at the front of the queue after having had a president who said firmly that we would be at the back of the queue. And there is a chance to really build bridges and indeed, in fact, as Nigel has said, actually mend some, because the general rhetoric of some of the government towards Trump during the campaign was a bit rude and actually rather silly in the circumstances.
But Conservative politicians are pretty split over whether Mr. Farage should have any role. Some of them say, look, he's elected to the European Parliament, but he's never been elected as an MP. He's certainly not part of the government. And of course, the official channels will all be open and Theresa May doesn't need him. Ian Duncan Smith, the former cabinet minister, said of Mr. Farage that his trip to America was an ego trip, not a diplomatic trip. And Downing Street today have been pretty pointedly against the whole idea of Nigel Farage having any kind of role, saying that he won't be the third person in the relationship between Mrs. May